Welcome back. With me on set today, I have Dr. Edo Osaige. You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And of course, one of our regular guests, Dr. Temu Arigode. You're welcome on set again today.
Thank you.
All right. So we're going to be talking about asthma. This is a topical issue. We have a large proportion of the population experiencing this condition, whether from those in the childhood years into adolescence, I mean teenagers, and then of course even adults, adult years. So talk to us about this.
Asthma is, like you said, is a common problem. Mm. It's actually a respiratory problem, mm-hmm. a problem that affects breathing, a problem of the lungs, the airways. Mm. You know, in the body we have airways. When you take in air, it goes through the larynx, which is a structure in the neck,
okay.
and then goes into the chest, where mm. you have the lungs. Mm. The major part of these airways are affected in asthma mm. is the bronchi. So what happens in asthma? It's an inflammation, actually,
okay.
a chronic inflammation. And by that I mean, for instance, if you have an injury on your hand, mm-hmm. it swells up,
yeah.
it starts bringing out fluid, and then it has a different appearance from the other parts of the skin. This same thing happens in the airway, but it goes on over time.
Okay.
So we call it a chronic inflammatory process.
Okay.
And there are some features of this chronic inflammatory process. There's hyper-responsiveness of the airways. The airways become hyper-responsive. They become more sensitive than they normally are to, you know, when you take in air, you take in particles, dust particles, and so many other things. So the airways respond more to these particles
okay.
as compared to before. And then also there is increased secretion of mucus. In your airways, you
okay.
have mucus there.
Okay.
So there are glands there that produce a substance we call mucus.
Okay.
It is a little viscid, a little thick. You know, it appears white.
Okay.
You know, it produces in a certain quantity, but mm. in asthma, it tends to be exaggerated.
So these are the
two problems
okay.
you tend to have in asthma. And then, like I said, there's hyper-responsive of the airway. Then, very importantly, there's constriction or narrowing of the airways in asthma,
okay.
which is what comes up as the symptoms they tend to have.
And so that of course, will now lead to breathing difficulties.
Yes, breathing difficulties.
And also, you notice there's wheezing. There could be funny noise when you're breathing.
Okay.
Because of the dyspnea.
Okay.
Then also sometimes there's this tendency, you know, to become restless.
Okay.
And also, you know when the saturation of oxygen is very quite low, mm. you know, some could go they could have a syncopal attack.
Okay.
You know, as the case may be, because the airway now is narrowed, you know, just like what Dr. Temu said, it's narrowed, there's hyper responsive of the airway, goblet cells, increased secretions, and all these, you know, going much more could lead to other sequelae, other complications,
okay.
you know, when it's not curtailed.
Okay. So is there a particular percentage of the population, a particular segment of population that is more prone to asthma? And if we've dealt with that, what are causes and predisposing factors that could lead to asthma? Mm.
Okay. In terms of population that is at risk of asthma, well, I think recent studies, there's still no female, we can't say it's more in this sex or more in that sex.
Okay.
We usually say that the predilection
yes.
seems to be similar in males and
or females. Okay.
But that is for genetic asthma.
Okay.
Genetic asthma. Asthma is believed to be genetic. Basically genetic with environmental factors surrounding it.
Okay.
You know, we call those ones triggers or inciters.
Mm-hmm.
As before you start having anybody who is predisposed to asthma, maybe in your family,
mm.
you know, it runs in families.
Mm-hmm.
Not all asthma, but a lot of asthma runs in families.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you have the person has this genetic predisposition.
Yeah.
By reason of what's inherited from the parents, he has the susceptibility, the likelihood to develop asthma, you know, so, and then he becomes exposed to some factors, which we call these trigger factors, like a trigger of a gun.
Okay.
They trigger what is already underlying.
Okay.
You know, there are a lot of them, a lot of trigger factors. We also have inciting factors.
Mm.
factors that genetic predisposition, they bring it up. You know, they kind of upregulate it. And so the person now develops the signs and features of asthma.
And looking at some of the trigger factors, you know, you could have pullings, okay. Dander's fours, you know, sometimes exposure, allergens and all that, yes, feathers and all of the, you know, and some persons aerosols, you know, smoke from the kitchen could be a trigger, you know, for some persons, not all, based on the allergies. Or dust could be a trigger factor. So you try to avoid those trigger factors. Because, you know, with exposure to those trigger factors, then tendency for hyper-responsiveness of the airway, you know, beyond the normal, because of the genetic or predisposition and all of that.
That's for a known asthmatic patient?
Yes, okay. known asthmatic patient, yes. Then also, some persons too along the way, although very few, you know, could develop it because of exposure to all of these, and the airway becomes sensitized, you know, in an abnormal way. You know, and over time, it becomes presenting with symptoms of asthma.
I want to add something to that. Like I said, not all asthma is genetic.
Okay.
Genetic with environmental factors contributing. Some asthma are largely environmental.
Okay.
For instance, you have what you call occupational asthma. There are some occupations that are associated with asthma.
Oh.
The person goes to work. And comes, he goes to work. While he's at work, he has asthmatic symptoms. Cough, difficulty with breathing, wheezing. That is, when you say someone is wheezing, it's like he's whistling.
Mm.
It's actually...
He's breathing.
Yes, he's breathing.
Whistling kind of sound.
Yes, for we doctors, we may not necessarily wait till the person wheezes. We put our stethoscope on the chest, and then we can hear his sound there. You know, but as it progresses, it becomes the wheezing, telling you that there's obstruction of the smaller airways.
Mm.
You know, so occupational asthma, person goes to work, he has the symptoms, he goes back home, no symptoms of asthma. Then we have exercise-induced asthma, you know, related to exercise.
Okay.
Yeah, so these are some entities that have been described that are not really, don't really have any genetic predisposition.
Okay.
But they have been described now to be asthma.
Okay, and they need intervention.
Yes, they need intervention too.
And a few also could be triggered by drugs, like some NSAIDs and all that. There could be some triggers. Yes.
Quite a gamut of...
Maybe if I can come in again there.
Yeah.
You know, NSAIDs. NSAIDs are...
As the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory
We use them for pain relief.
Okay.
People that have joint problems, joint pain and all that. You know, and these NSAIDs, generally we don't give it in people that are asthmatic because... The way they walk, they can cause constriction of the airways.
Okay.
They can cause secretion of substances that will cause the airway to be narrowed. So if you give it to someone that is asthmatic, aspirin, these are examples of these NSAIDs, aspirin, ibuprofen, naproxen, and so on and so forth, they could, you know, actually precipitate an asthmatic attack.
So if someone is a known asthmatic patient, this kind of medication shouldn't go and self-medicate and take any of those things.
Okay. Yes.
Interesting. Okay. Can we just, again, just quickly run down some of the signs and symptoms again? Just let's highlight them. So if a patient or someone is experiencing some of this, they can have an idea, maybe an asthmatic attack is coming on, or this is what it could be.
Yes, it could be coughing. You know, most time it could be dry cough. But when the cough it prolonged, they could expectorate, but thick tenacious sputum, you know, and also it's wheezing, the noisy kind of breathing. But with the stethoscope, you pick that, you say, okay, there's bronchi in the chest. Then also dyspnea, difficulty in breathing, you know, breathing, you know, with much exaction, you know, just like the exercise induced, occupational induced asthma and all that. So it could start subtly, but as you know, more secretions and more difficulty, it could be much more intense, mild, moderate, or severe dyspnea, as the case may be. Okay. Then also, most times, also there could be tachycardia, because increased heart rate, you know, in this patient and all that. And you see the restlessness, you know, they could be anxious. Okay. Then you know, prostration, you know, this, all of these, you know, could be elaborated.
And all of this need to work, be together, or be observed. The majority of them observed together, not just picking up one and.
It helps us to know, you know, asthma has stages, even in an asthmatic attack, it has stages. We call them severity criteria. That's how severe is this asthma. For instance, before he mentioned the prostration, before an asthmatic gets prostrated, it means he has been having the attack for a long time.
It's
an ominous sign.
Okay.
We don't wait till the person gets...
You don't want to get there.
Yes. In fact, that may be an indication for admission in the intensive care unit. Prostration, low blood pressure, and so on and so forth. And low levels of oxygen in the blood and all that. But the initial symptoms, like you mentioned, cough, difficulty breathing, wheezing, and I want to say something again, nighttime cough. Nighttime cough, because we use that to... In treating asthmatics, because we have the treatment for chronic asthmatics, we want to know how well are they responding to treatment. So we ask for nighttime cough. They usually have nighttime cough. What can you do? Asthma is not a death sentence, like you have said. So what can you do? What can you do to really help yourself if you find yourself in that instance? First of all, you have to watch out for, we talked about triggers, the things that trigger your attack. We mentioned some common ones, fried foods, smoke, feathers, poultry feathers. Maybe you have a poultry, you know, you limit your exposure to, you know, the birds, the feathers of the birds. Then your upholstery. Your upholstery shouldn't be that,
with fur, aerosol spray.
As much as possible. You could change your rug to carpet.
Okay.
That'll do better.
I'll have tiles.
Having a rug and all that. And then once you are able to identify, okay, these are the things that cause my attack, then you can say, okay, you do as much as possible to avoid them.
Okay.
There shouldn't be any problem.
Okay.
Then avoiding the triggers also, you know, there's the exercise-induced asthma. You know, you don't want to go to mild exactions. You know, you're going to sweat so much and all that. You're going to be, you know, lose a lot of fluid and all. That could be a trigger. So you could go on aerobic activities, you know, mild, take it mild instead of going to the moderate and the severe, you know, exercise.
And of course, we'll have the aerobics instructor on shortly, so stay tuned for that. So you can have some examples of the kind of exercises that you can, you know, be engaged in. So,
okay. Also, what else can you do? Usually when you come to the hospital, the doctor gives you some drugs.
Okay.
Like we said in explaining how asthma happens, we need the airways are narrowed, so we need to open them up.
Okay.
So you may have something like what we call a Ventolin inhaler.
All right.
Contains a drug, salbutamol.
Okay.
Which helps to open up the airways. So they usually give that to you, and then they ask you, they train you, they need to teach you how to use it. Because most people really don't know how to use it. They have it, but they don't know how to use it.
Okay.
So your doctor would explain that to you. There's a way you hold it and put it in your nose, and it's more effective than just using it anyhow.
See them sometimes, you tell them, take a puff, two puffs, with deep inspiration. You know, that opens the airways and all that. And also, adding to more to what he said, that's the beta agonist, that's the short-acting beta agonist, salbutamol, Ventolin. There are other types. Then also, depends on the kind of asthma. You know, he talked about the mild, moderate, severe, and all that. Looking at the diurnal variation, you know, the one that occurs more often at night, becomes scary. So instead of using a beta agonist, you may want to go further. You know, something that will act over a longer period of time. Then looking at the long-acting, that's the short-acting. You know, when you take it right away, you save it. The airways is opened. You feel relieved. You know, coupled with the lifestyle modification to avoid the triggers. Then when you're looking at the long acting, you know, the ones you're going to talk about, salmeterol, formoterol, they are drugs to use, you know, over a period of time. Then it could be so bad, you want to bring in the steroids. You could bring the steroids, you know, gradually, you know, through the inhalational type, through the IVs, as the case may be. And all that, you know, and you know, putting it straight, you know, we have a broad classification for the treatment and management of asthma. You have the reliever, you know, for the acute conditions, exacerbations. Then you also have the preventers, you know, those ones you're going to take, you know, to prevent, you know, you having frequent attacks.